as part of the digital initiative by Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam University. Here is video lecture on VLSI technology, and the topic for the lecture is epitaxial growth, in continuation with the previous lecture what we have studied. I am your faculty Sangeeta Mangesh from Department of Electronics and Communication Engineering, JSS Academy of Technical Education, Noida. What we are going to cover in today's lecture is the additional things associated with the epitaxial growth process, that is doping and autodoping. What are the process selection and capabilities? What is exactly the meaning of buried layer? What is exactly epitaxial defects? Microscopic growth rates. Here there is a BURIED is the spelling. Now, the learning objectives, like what I expect you to learn out of this particular lecture, is you should be able to what all the process are associated, or what are the emerging results as a consequence of your epitaxial growth, and what are the what are the benefits of such epitaxial growths as far as your electronic devices are concerned, or design of electronic devices is concerned. So, what are those benefits, what are those things which are involved in the designing. Now, very first thing we have seen that the epitaxial growth process, when you are going getting it done in the horizontal reactor, is dependent on three parameters we saw: the concentration, the temperature and the pressure. And these particular, like the diameter of the furnace, then the rate, like tube through which the particular flow is happening, then the viscosity, or the what you call the property velocity of the gas, also plays very important role. Now, we have also seen the relationship between NS and NJ in the previous lecture, where we have seen the two limiting cases. When NS is approximately equal to NG, you are having the actual deposition happening, and if it is if NS is approaching 0, the whatever the dependent is, transportation dependent will be the growth rate. So, these were the two things what we have studied in the previous lecture. Coming back to when the this particular diffusion, like this epitaxial growth is happening, you have multiple what you call byproducts getting created. Now, there are two ways in which these byproducts can hamper the silicon epitaxial growth process. One, we call it as a macroscopic, that is a major impacts, and microscopic. So, macroscopic, many divide these particular what you call impacts in the two zones. Now, one of the zone what I told you is macroscopic. Macroscopic is basically related to the major impacts which are caused due to wafer from the backside as well as from the edges. Like, these are basically processes which are, or the what you call contaminants or dopants which are impacting as far as your what you call environment is concerned, or the other than what you are intended to do. Similarly, there is another what you call byproduct which is getting formed, that is because of the part of this particular process. Now, when the dopant, there are some contaminants on the surface, or there are some minor impurities onto the surface, or micro defects into the this particular surface, those can also have the impact. And therefore, unintentional doping of the layer is due to auto doping processes. We call it as auto doping. Many times, along with the normal epitaxial growth, there is a tendency, or there is a widespread what you call process in which we add the dopant particles along with your silicon. Now, if you want to create, in case of your BJT, if you want to create P layer, and above you create N layer, again you want to create P layer. So, you need to add a dopant in the silicon wafer itself, or when you are depositing the silicon or growing epitaxial growth itself, you are introducing, that time only the dopant is introduced. And such dopants are basically introduced in the presence of hydrogen, that gives you stability, and therefore, they are added in the form of, in the presence of hydrogen. And the materials or the products, like since the impurities are boron, phosphorus and antimony. Okay. So, the arsenic. So, you are having these three, that is diboron, phosphine and arsine. These are the three basic impurities which are introduced as a part of auto doping process. Now, this auto doping, okay, this is basically doping which is intentionally being done, and unintentionally when the doping is happening, whatever byproducts are getting created, those byproducts also contaminate the wafer, and that contamination we call it as autodoping. Now, these are basically, I told you already, hydrides are used, that is diborane, phosphine and arsine. These are the hydrides of these impurities which are used, because hydrogen gives you thermal stability. Now, this is basically advantages also, and there are consequences also because of the autodoping. Now, autodoping can degrade the performance of the device in turn, if they can result into leakage currents, or they can result into different problems that can incur into the wafer. Now, along with the intentional, I told you already the definition of autodoping is, along with the intended dopant, if there is a byproduct, and unintentional dopants also appear or create, get introduced into the wafer substrate, we call them as autodoping. Now, these autodopants or auto is basically, they enhance the transition region between the substrate and the epi layer. Now, shape of this profile is being shown. Here you are having a solid state diffusion happening, please understand, and here you are, this is the autodoping tail. There is minor, like you have very minor difference when suddenly dopants are getting introduced and the byproducts are also simultaneously getting introduced into the substrate as a consequence of autodoping. And therefore, this particular thing is to be properly, this is a time dependent phenomena, and you, this particular curve gives you exact difference. You need to check out when this doping is happening, and when if you have prolonged exposure, that the consequence will be autodoping. And this particular autodoping phenomena is being majorly studied to prevent the reliability issues, or to overcome the reliability issues which may incur when the device is being fabricated into those wafers, and that is given by equation V should be less than, therefore, the velocity at which growth velocity at which the epitaxial growth is to be initiated, rapid growth will have higher mobility, and therefore, the deposition rate will be higher, and there is more possibility that these autodopants can get introduced, and therefore, the rate at which the growth has to be initiated must be less than 2 times d by t raised to the power 1 by 2. That means, it should be, there should be you have to check out how much is the substrate diffusion constant and what is the exposure or the deposition time you are giving for the dopant or the impurity or the particular source of epitaxial growth that is being flown over the wafer. So, this particular equation gives you that particular idea, and this is very, very important, because that is a deciding factor for which you need to carry out the process. Now, this autodoping can be prevented. This here again it is being shown. Here you are having the n plus buried layer, here it is n layer, and here is, it is a p substrate. So, many times when this layer is being grown, or this particular epitaxial, so impurities from p substrate can get, because of elevated temperature, can come out, or can get aggravated or get dislodged because of the activation energy sufficient if they get, and they can create create autodoping, and these can hamper the, or this particular thing can hamper the performance of the device in turn. So, to prevent that, you have one more thing, that is you add a back seal layer. Now, what is this back seal layer? This back seal layer is generally of silicon dioxide or silicon nitride, having thickness 0.3 to 1 micrometer. Similarly, you can have requisites, edge strip, edges should be stripped to avoid the nodule or particle, like you can have nodule formation or particle formation during the epitaxial. So, you need to avoid the, you need not have, you ensure that there are no sharp edges. Then epi layer deposition should be on the back of the wafer should be, should range between 15 to 20 micrometer, so that that is not creating any autodopant into it. there are hardware modifications also being carried out for this preventing this particular auto doping, and those are basically related to the susceptor modification. You have a contamination free susceptor placed at a tilted angle so that the boundary conditions are being met. Then you have double sided polished wafers so that there are no contaminants residing on the back side of the wafer also. Now, when you are going for choice of this particular source for silicon, in case of silicon, so there are four major sources we have seen already in the previous lecture, and the most preferred is, I told you already, silicon tetrachloride. Now, here please understand, this is a comparative table which is giving you the overall idea of all the four, what you call, choices of the sources, and when are those, or what are their plus and minus points. Please remember, this particular is basically in the negate, or this particular thing is in the negation, like it is in the negative spirit being denoted, because you know already silane has got no chlorination, and therefore there is no deposition on the wall, and therefore though it is shown it has got no as far as deposition on the wall of the furnace is concerned, there is zero deposition rate in this case, and therefore we have degraded it as 5, that is the worst, like you don't have any deposition. As far as deposition on the wall is concerned, it is 0, that is why we have treated it as 5. But then you have something known as silicon tetrachloride, which is the workhorse of this particular epitaxial growth process. This work in both ways, that is atmospheric pressure as well as at the reduced pressure. You can have this will work from around 1000 degrees to 1200 degrees centigrade or 1300. You have the growth rate being decided from 0.2 to 2 micrometer per minute, 0.1 to 0.6. So, less slower will be the growth rate, better will be the aggregation, and better will be the nucleation, better will be the growth, better will be the orientation, less will be the defect in density, and less will be the crystal stress and other factors. So, this is what is the best workhorse. Now, please remember, here there is a presence of chlorine. So, naturally it has got maximum shifts being considered, and you have got at reduced pressure and reduced temperature, if you are carrying out the process at a slow deposition rate, the defect pattern shift will be minimum. As it is having a chlorine into it, the deposition on the wall is maximum, and selective growth is best in its case. As far as your silicon, okay, here you are having silane, then you have the silicon tetrachloride, then you have something known as dichlorosilane, and you have got this is known as silane. Now, silane is preferred when you want to go for very limited, this is basically non-economical when you want to go for reduced pressure silicon deposition or epitaxial growth, then you prefer silane. But overall, we saw already in the last lecture, that is N when we call it, that is efficiency. Now, efficiency of any deposition process is basically number of amount of the silicon which got deposited and amount that is introduced, ratio amount that got deposited to the amount that is introduced. Now, here since it is slightly an expensive affair, as the growth rate is very less, this is generally not preferred because economy involved is not feasible. So, best or the workhorse of this particular epitaxial growth process, or commercially maximum whatever is being used, is your silicon tetrachloride. Though there is a deposition on the furnace wall, that deposition is cleared periodically by purging hydrogen gas and cleaning the wall of the furnace with the airs and blowing the inert gases, and this particular method is used because it is giving you best, since it has got chlorine into it, chlorine, so selective growth is best. Apart from it, as far as expensive and efficiency of this deposition or efficiency of epitaxial growth is concerned, these two are also considered dependent upon the temperature and pressure requirements, but because these are also viable at reduced pressure. But please remember, there are certain issues like pattern shift and wall deposition is concerned. These two are giving some consequences of that, and therefore economy wise these two are generally not preferred. So this is the basically the workhorse. I told you this is the workhorse. This is the main source which is generally widely accepted. Now since it has got, I told you, it has got if it is properly controlling the pressure and temperature, if you carry out selectively at lower growth rate, it can have you can have controlled defect densities and you can have better depositions. Now let us go ahead with the this is the slide which is explaining you all the four sources with respect to pressure and temperature. So if you see, this is the growth rate in micrometer per minute and this is the temperature and pressure. Now if you see clearly, you will see that this is my silane, I call it, and this is my silicon tetrachloride. So silicon tetrachloride, if you see here, see, it has got very controlled as compared to this silane has got maximum growth rate. You have got maximum growth rate, so more growth rate, but then I told you already there is a possibility of pattern shift is minimum, but growth rate is very less as compared to this, and the temperature is also very less. So if you elevate the temperature, it steeply increases, and along with it you will have some certain goodies, that is defects and other things coming into picture, because the this particular gas is very sensitive. Basically it is very sensitive to presence of oxygen, and that is what is preventing its use on the widespread, because presence of oxygen you cannot avoid in any case. And since these contaminants or the presence of impurity is very sensitive to any presence of impurity, and therefore this needs a lot of precautions to be taken into account, and therefore overall efficiency wise and economy wise this process becomes quite expensive, and therefore though it is good, it is not being preferred. Rather than that, this process has got more efficiency, better efficiency, economically better throughput, and therefore this is the most commercially viable process. In any case, you know already byproducts. Now here also you must remember, when the silicon tetrachloride reacts, after certain point of time when the exposure increases, you have, instead of this, okay, dopant, if you see this particular molar concentration on this particular this one, so you will see that after certain point there will be etching started, like if you expose it to longer duration or something like. So you have to be very precise in the rate at which this deposition is happening and the exposure time for which this particular source is flowing over the surface of your wafer, and that is why this particular the process associated is exhaustively studied, most studied, okay, it is very well studied, and therefore this is the most recommended process. It is exhaustively studied, nucleation patterns, defects, everything has been properly evaluated, and therefore this is the most recommended process. Now another utility of your epitaxial layer is your buried layer. Now what is this buried layer? Buried layer is basically whenever you want to have more than one layer getting deposited on one another. So you need to isolate the previous layer, like you have collector, emitter, okay, you have collector here, you are having NPN, you need to isolate it, you have some auto doping over here and you have this N plus buried layer below it, so that you have proper isolation of these materials which have been, or these layers which are forming your bipolar transistor. so that there are no leakage currents because of or reverse leakage current when you are operating that particular device, and there are switching voltages being applied to these terminals. Now, this presence of buried layer complicates the epitaxial growth due to autodoping defects. This is very, very important, and therefore, pattern distortions, okay, and that can those pattern distortions are also very they also impact the epitaxial growth process, and therefore, you have to remember that the growth rates are different in crystallographic directions, and therefore, buried layers can be shifted relative to high doping, and pattern can be distorted or washed out. So, you have to be very, very careful when you are having these buried layers and when you want to carry out epitaxial growth on it, because those buried layers can hamper the growth, can introduce unwanted autodopants into your epitaxial growth. Now, how to minimize them? You know already the consequence can create sidewall, can shrinkage or enlargement of the pattern, they can heavily doped pattern can like impact, and therefore, to minimize this pattern shifts, you need to check the crystal or alignments, you need to reduce the growth rate, so that precision or mobility will be reduced, and therefore, you will have proper deposition rate. You can have a reduction in the chlorine content, so avoid use of the first what you call a workhorse, you can use silane instead. So, reducing growth pressure and reducing growth temperature. So, these are the what you call remedial actions which you can work on for improvising the epitaxial growth when there are buried layers inside your substrate. Now, when you carry out this particular epitaxial growth process, the important aspect you need to study is the crystal defect. There are multiple crystal defects which can result as a consequence of, you I already told you the epitaxial growth has got three basic concepts. You do not want chemical reaction, you want exact lattice constant to match, and you want thermal expansion coefficient to match, or you have thermally mismatch should not be there. So, mismatch can have like you can bear with when you are having hetero epitaxy, you can bear with thermal mismatch, you can bear with what you call lattice mismatch. In fact, that is appearing in many of the layers, but then you cannot you cannot go ahead with if you have exhaustive a chemical reaction happening between those two materials which is to be deposited and which is already existing. So, therefore, please remember whenever there is mismatch in the lattice constant or mismatch in the thermal expansion, there is a possibility that there is originate the crystal growth or crystal defect may get originated within the layer, EP layer, and therefore, these crystal defects can gather the metals and therefore, produce lead. They can what you call excessive mobility they will impart to the metal ions, and that will result into leakage current getting produced to the device and thereby compromising reliability of the device which is getting fabricated into that wafer. Then they can have electrically active regions, and that can also result into leakage current getting produced or leakage of the charge carriers getting or unwanted unreliable operation from the device. They may create issue in the photolithographic steps also, when the photolithography we will see that. So, photolithography may when we are like adding the light that can create dispersion in the light, and that can also create problems in the photolithographic steps. So, these crystal defects, how these crystal defects are? See, here you can see there is across the horizontal plane, there is absence of atoms when the epitaxial growth is being done. Similarly, here you are having unwanted atoms getting getting deposited in the epitaxial growth when the what you call process is happening. Now, this can result, you can have different defects, different what you call precipitates resulting into stacking faults, process related defects which are slips, displacement, dislocations. You have something known as hillocks, stacking faults associated with nucleation when happening, when the atoms are getting getting placed one above the other. In the buried layer formation, stacking faults or pyramid effects also result in the low surface mobility. these misfit locations. See, this is the film, you have perfect match. Here you will see that there is a strained, here the in the film the atomic what you call bonds are strained, here they are relaxed. See, but these are basically the defects which can get incurred when you are having the deposition onto the layer. Now this particular, all the five types of defects are being depicted over here. This is the line misfit or line what you call dislocation happening in the crystal. This is the stacking fault rising because of the nucleation defects. This is the stacking fault or impurity precipitate caused when the contamination is presence of, because of the presence of contamination. This is hillock getting created because of the contamination or nucleation. Here this is also bulk stacking fault which happens or which intersects the substrate and thereby extends into the layer also. Here it is extending within the substrate also because it is appearing in the epitaxial layer. So these defects can produce hazardous or can like they can be very dangerous as far as your reliability of device is concerned, because they will compromise the performance of the device. So you need to address them very carefully while designing or while developing your growing your the epitaxial film. Another advantage or another feature of epitaxy is the selective growth. It is very useful when you have particular area or particular area which is to be grown. Only for this particular area you are growing this silicon. Okay, so you have silicon dioxide over here, but here you want the silicon dioxide having particular resistivity, particular property, and the same silicon dioxide or same material or same epi layer can be grown, which is amorphous in nature. It is basically heteroepitaxy can be can happen over here, and you can have the crystal orientation can be you can have amorphous growth of silicon dioxide having specific resistivity which is suitable to behave or to check its performance as an insulator exactly over here within this layer. So this is basically the important feature of epitaxy, where you can have single crystal silicon is fabricated in a small designated area. You can have single, here you can have amorphous, here you can have single crystal also. Single crystal silicon I am using, and I am having some specific conductivity, specific resistivity only for this particular area I can define. So this is one of the best feature which can be useful for multiple device fabrications or exploring different properties from the devices when you are fabricating multiple devices. Another and the last of this particular feature is you have monocrystalline growth as a function of temperature, and therefore when you are growing this, there are multiple inferences which have been drawn. When silicon atoms are adsorbed on the surface of the substrate after a chemical reaction, these atoms find proper crystallographic locations and align themselves on those locations. When the growth rates are high, insufficient time is there for the migration, and therefore they lead into improper or polycrystalline, like the orientation changes, and therefore the single crystal, rather than single crystal, you will have polycrystalline growth process. With an occurrence of crystallographic sites at the leading edge, the lateral rather than vertical, it will be lateral rather than vertical. So the silicon growth will be rather lateral rather than vertical if it has got leading edges. The adsorbed atoms compete with the dopant atoms, leading to nucleation and nucleation, and that will result into stacking faults. So when you have dopant, you have to ensure that there is a proper growth rate being incorporated, so that there is proper nucleation energy being imparted, there is proper adsorption happening, and the film of right property gets deposited onto the silicon. So at the end, let us summarize. If you are able to answer these questions, that is, what is the importance of auto doping, how that can be controlled, then what is the buried layer, here also buried layer, single R it is, then source, what is the choice of source in the epitaxial growth of silicon, and what are the different crystallographic defects. If you are able to answer these questions, that is how autodoping is happening, what are the consequences of autodoping, what are the crystal defects, what can that can incur, what are the consequences of them, how can we avoid autodoping, how can we avoid source, like what are the different choices of materials and when are those materials to be used, what are the, like which is the workhorse of the epitaxial layer. So, if you know all these things, if you can conclude or comprehend all these things, we will go ahead with the specific process or specialist process of epitaxial growth, that is molecular beam epitaxy. So, let us proceed further in the next lecture. See you. Goodbye, take care and God bless.